then have to get the majority, the vast majority of the street residents in that street to agree to it. So we do a survey of that street, filling the question there. And unless we get around about 98% of the people in that street wanting to be part of it, then again, that would be something that we perhaps overlook if they weren't supporting it in a particular area. So we want the vast majority of people in the street to sign up to it as well. And then we look at establishing a zone in that area and appointing a coordinator in the street, and they would watch coordinator all the tasks.
Thank you, Chair. I think Stuart and Mike are quite correct that none of us enjoy these cold calls in any way whatsoever. And I don't know what the final answer is, but can I tell you a little story? My son came to visit me 12 months ago, and we were having a chat, and the phone went, and he walked off to the phone, put it down, and walked back over to me, and I said, "Well, why don't you answer the phone?" He said, "No, it's a cold call." I said, "What you want to do?" He says, "Well, while they're waiting for me, they're not ringing anyone else up." I said, "Well, how often do you do that?" He said, "Well, we record is 37 minutes at the moment." And even if that's a tape one, he just picks it up, doesn't put it down, just picks it up and leaves it going. And his attitude was, while that phone's being engaged, they can't be speaking to anyone else. But I don't know what the answer is, I really don't.
Thanks. I mean, I think there are one or two people who've tried to send invoices to people who've given cold calls for the time that they've taken. Any more points, comments?
Chair, my view is that I don't think there's anyone in the room that wouldn't want to support it, but how much do you want to support it? What are the cost implications, the time and efforts of our officers? Is this a priority against the other areas of work that we're all working on at the moment? So my view is unless we know what level of commitment we want to make to it and how it's going to be cost, we're often being told where we can't save money, but we're always being told where we can spend more money. Unless it's costed and evaluated and a business case made, then what do we do? There's no solution. Do we note it? Do we ask for further report? What do we do? I just confused if there are cost implications, and you'll know from your department, if we go to every house in Fulham, which certainly will be cost implications, if we stay within our budget and just a gradual increase, I think that's probably something we can say yes to and then move forward. I'm a bit confused about the cost.
Thanks, Steve. A minute. Stuart.
Just come back on some of the issues, including the issue of costs, which Steve might have been raised. Somebody mentioned linking at the doorstep with the GoPro. That's entirely my fault. Why is there no solution to not stopping? I guess, well done by two, I suppose. I guess in the gift of the committee to decide what it wants to do with any sort of part of it. In terms of what was said about call centres and jobs, most call centres are there actually to receive calls. Most companies will encourage people to phone up rather than including the council. The council does exactly that with the street team search board, doesn't it? It invites people to email, and that's what they're there for. In terms of control, the rules are, there are some rules there, but the issue is that the rules ought to be tighter. For example, this whole business of silent calls, which was just referred to, why does that happen? That happens because they've got a computer that's capable of dialing 10 or 20 numbers all at once, and if two people pick up, then they go for one and leave the other one handy. Well, that's an unacceptable practice. I don't care, that's an unacceptable practice. And it is something that nationally ought to be dealt with. Yeah? The news website, or the thing of the good section of the town, was about making it easy for the regulators to communicate with one another. We all know what government's like, it's worse than anything, localising Ayrshire. They certainly don't talk about cross-crossing, it's not cross anything, is it? And also talking about the threshold at which action can be taken by government. So that's the easy thing, isn't it, to get the rules right. The way that we want them to work. I think from what we've heard in terms of what the council is doing, I'm coming back to Steve's book on the definite link that's been found in Scotland, which is a website that I was looking at in the seminar that I've been to, there's a definite link with health. And I think I might say from what was said, we have a sort of money from health to see, if you like, to explore whether we can make a difference to people's sense of well-being already. I mean, my suggestion, having heard what's been said, is that the committee take an interest and ask for, a report back, once we know what the evidence is. Then you can prioritise, can't you? Because if it has a massive effect on people's health, it might be something that's worth prioritising. It has no effect whatsoever. No effect whatsoever, but everybody feels just as terrified as they were, just as unhealthy. Then clearly we're going to have the wrong groups, don't we? But if we've got a slug of money already from health that says, do this piece of work, let's see what makes a difference, I would just say, let's ensure that from a member point of view, that we're able to give instruction to executive directors to make sure that we can get the feedback and get the involvement of all the departments. We're not government, we're not national government. Surely we can get that level of cross-cutting right within an organisation the size of the world. And I think that's probably where we are at the moment, is where we will be after spray out Mudd's campaign and makes whatever findings known to health and to yourselves, then the debate moves on, doesn't it?
Steve.
Yes, I totally agree. Totally against this. Most of us. The only problem I can see, I've got, because of the business I do, we've got four lines now, and we've got between 5, 10, 12 calls a day. And I'd say 90% of them are from abroad and usually on VoIP. So it's not even costing the call any money. And whatever legislation or gizmos you get here, that won't legislative exams to people. So that's the only concern. Steve's sort of saying, I don't know how far we can go because I can't see when the 95% or 90-95% of calls are abroad and not going to be able to legislate against them.
I'm more confused now, Jay, because if you talk to people where health money would be spent, you talk to people, I say, what's the silver bullet? What would be if you had
only had £100 to spend, what you spend it on. And health people say smoking cessation, the more people you stop smoking, has a bigger benefit on health issues than, say, cold calls or what have you. And I'm not sure where this health money, if it's all been targeted on this and agreements have been made, then spend what we've got, but no more. The other issue is, if it's in a list of other priorities, it's not been ranked, evaluated against what's the best for you.
Thanks, Chair. If I can just say to them, the health funds that Derek referred to were for 1340, so basically 3 months. And we won't have those funds going forward until 1450, so they won't be available moving forward. But of course, you're expecting to see this, Chair, not everything's about money, is it? The notice of motion from Councillor Kelly talks about reference about please encouraging the no nuisance calls campaign. But I think also, Chair, there's a point made, shared by Councillor Kelly, about other departments. And of course, this department has, apart from training standards, not that much interaction with some of these customers or residents that we're talking about, Chair. One of the things we can do relatively easily. I can do that to me, is to speak to my colleagues, my other two strategic director colleagues about at least the communication message going out, particularly when social services are going out to see some of the other people saying there's so many people we unfortunately have to deal with because of the financial situation through our finance department in terms of hardship payments, etc. So, Chair, I'm more than happy to get some cross-departmental working in terms of highlighting this issue to those members, to those colleagues. But just to be clear, we haven't got any further funding. Whilst I'd love to be able to say I'm sure I can get some, Chair, I can't.
Thanks, Kevin, and thanks for the idea of coming to the department. I did think that was quite a key point that you made, because ultimately it is, I'm not mistaken, the corporate plan talks about protecting the most vulnerable in our community, and this is an item which does affect the most vulnerable more than any other group of residents in rural. So clearly, I think I was a seconder to this motion. I don't think it was asking for a huge amount of funds, but I mean, it's clear that you as a committee to decide where you want to go with it. From my point, I do think it is a significant issue. It's certainly one that many residents are concerned about. What we as a council can do, I accept, is always a matter of debate, but I'd be a little loath if we just dismiss it.
Might be helpful, Chair. I think there's no money associated with the fire on that road, and I think most people will see it as national legislation taking the lead on this. So I think if we could, urge officers and the committee to agree to the final paragraph, that we actually lobby those with more power than us to do something about it. And I think we should note the report, but refer it to the newly created committee here if they wish to take up any further than what we've got, and take note of the comments made, practical issues about, cross communication across departments. And that would be the basis of a way forward. If it's helpful for Stuart to start.
Yeah, I think that's fair enough. I think it's too late in the fiscal year to start setting the screening plan. I mean, the issue really is if funds are spent on it, we're going to do some of our training standards, but you receive, or the committee wishes to receive feedback on the success of that, and that's a matter for that. But certainly, cross off into writing that, as has been said, cross off to make sure that those who are trying to travel as well as the sector are up to speed with the settings. I don't know what's going on.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah.
With that, we will move on to the next item, which is the update of the recommendations of the reportedly under occupation scrutiny task force. I thought this was excellent, actually, in the way that both it was done originally and the way that it was considered.
This might just be the maybe one, it might be more to the sensitivity of the group opposite.
Thank you.